Let's pray together before we get started. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that we could have the opportunity once again to be able to talk with precious saints of God, brothers and sisters of like faith, dear God, about how precious your word is, Lord, and how true it is, Father. And I ask that you'd bless this meeting, dear God. Use us, Lord, in whatever way you can for your glory and your honor, dear God. And may we be true to your word. Close our mouths, dear God, if we were to say anything contrary to your word, Lord, that we do not bring any disgrace upon your name. We ask this, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, for those that don't know that word. I guess all y'all know who already know who I am. And it is a privilege to get to meet all of you. And we'll get to meet you more after the meeting, especially when it's a small one. Indiana was a little harder, but let me just, how many of you guys, I know we're doing this like in two parts tonight. I planned on talking about women in the Bible only to start with, but I'm going to do that in a second in the second part. So those that want to stay to go through that, we're going to go through that. The first probably, and we got plenty of time. They said as long as I don't get too loud and wake everybody up. So I'll try to turn my volume down. They said we can stay as long as we want. So, hook them on up in here. We'll talk with them. So, and Yana will be in here at the second half as well. And we'll be going really deep into that. And something I've wanted to do for a long time. And the other thing, though, but what I really felt impressed to talk about tonight are the two witnesses. And I ran into a little situation over the weekend. Not anybody said anything to me other than I had somebody say to me that, well, you know, the two witnesses are man and woman. And I'm like, I thank God for men and women. It's nothing, that doesn't mean that, because anybody that knows me well enough knows I understand Hebrew very well, so I'm not fluent, but that's his business. He'll take care of that. But I study Hebrew from a scholastic standpoint. I've done it in university. I've done it in Israel. Studied in Ulpan in Israel. I lived in Israel. I live in Israel part-time now. Sister Julie was so kind to try to help us. We went back over trying to find a house. We still haven't found it yet, but we know that we will. So we're going back again to try to find our home over there, preferably one that's bomb-proof. And so pray for us for that there. But when it comes to the Hebrew language, though, it's amazing. It's like a conspiracy that has taken place. Certain people don't want you knowing the truth. They want to keep women suppressed. And I know when I was up in North Carolina, Brother Paul was there, and Brother Paul, you was in the other room, I think, when I was talking to Brother Austin and Brother Doug. Now, you want to talk about all them guys. It was such a pleasure to be with them. I mean, we woke up the next morning, we come down the stairs, and what I love to see in a home is when people are around talking about the Word of God. And my son even tells me, because Brother Paul loves children, and he started telling me stories that Brother Paul was telling him about the Lord, you know. And then I come down and the brothers are all sitting around talking about the Bible, you know, and the women are over in another room. They're all talking about the Word of God. And I thought, now that is a nice place to come into. And other places we went, we didn't see that, you know. So it's really, it's pleasant to see that, and because that's what it should be, you know. I know the cares of the life take it different, but at any point, Brother Austin says to me, he says, now, Brother Steve, you know, you were talking in the Hebrew last night about, you know, God never created man to rule his wife and that it wasn't a divine decree. And I can see all that plain, brother. I mean, that was really good. But, you know, there's still an order. Hallelujah. You believe that, don't you, brother? We're still, but you know, God he says, we're the priest of the home. I said, if you can show it to me, Brother Austin, I'd like to see it. I said, now God does have an order. It's not that God's not orderly. I said, but if you can show me that, I'll agree with it. And So he asked me another question. And we're going to go into this a little bit later, but he said, Brother Steve, he said, don't you think, though, that God has ordained, he said, you know, Paul said man is the head of the woman, and I said, do you know what that is in Greek? I said, you're thinking in English. It wasn't written in English. See, kephale is koine Greek. It means source. Now you're starting to rhyme with Hebrew, because God took Eve from Adam. Christ come from the bosom of God. So that's why he says God is the head of Christ, and the man is the head of the woman. It's not head, it's the way we translated it. It's source. We'll get into all that, though. So anyway, I did ask him one thing, though. So I want you to think about this. I said, if God is only going to hold a woman to obeying her husband as the Word of God, and that's the way it is, and I'll get to that one, too, for you. That'll surprise you. I know God knows that everybody's not going to know that. So if you don't know it and you go through your whole life, it's no big deal. And a marriage, really, to begin with, is a partnership. It's when a man and woman, they love each other. It's not, you know, I'll tell you what you're going to do like this. You know, no, it's like, you know, honey, what do you think about that? You know, I think it's all right. You know, in Hebrew, when he says, Ezra kana gidol, that's what we say in Hebrew. It means, you translate it in English as a helper corresponding to him is one way, or helper suitable to him. But in Hebrew, it doesn't mean that. I think there's 19 times the word Ezra is used in Hebrew. One time it was used for Eve. All the other times it's used to God. And he is our Ezra, but it doesn't make him subordinate, and we know that. Kane Gidon means against him, but not in a negative connotation. It is to balance the marriage. You know, I mean, now, brothers, you know how we are, you know. Baby, I saw this boat, and I'm going to buy that rascal. I need the checkbook. You know, oh, what's that? You know, it balances is what it is. And that's what God, that's the word he uses in Hebrew, is to balance that relationship. So, anyway. The two witness issue, though, really became an issue. How many of you guys already know who the two witnesses are? Go ahead. Your brother-in-law and who? No, I'm just kidding, sister. I'm just kidding.
I honestly have a conflicting. So hopefully you'll get deep into that, because I go back and forth between, is it Elisha and Enoch, or is it Elisha and Moses? Because they would receive the word of Moses. However, Enoch is the one that was taken up.
Right.
And
here's the reason why I felt impressed to say it. Because after hearing this doctrine over the weekend, and it wasn't preached on or nothing, it's just a nice, really precious little sister came up to me, and I just said the word two witnesses about something. And she said, oh, yes, we already know that. That's man and woman. That's what God is going to do. And I'm like, wow. All right, now I know the one about Elijah and Enoch. I know the one about Elijah and Moses. I even know the one about Elijah and John. Okay, there's that one too. And then I also know about the one about the Old and New Testament. They're the two witnesses. And then, of course, this was a new one for me. And I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. So anyway, now I will say this. It doesn't matter. God don't care what we think. He doesn't care what I think. And so if I don't get it right, or if the rest of us don't get it right, it's not going to change a thing. It doesn't matter, because he's going to do however he wants to do. So my wife's making me drink water now. No more Coke for me. Oh well.
Always Coke, yeah.
Yeah, I love Coke. I really love. I'm shaking, but no, I'm just kidding. Let's go first off, though, just to Revelation. And I want to talk about the different reasons why the others are chosen. And the reason, another reason I thought this would be a perfect time to do this video is because I've taught on it many, many times in the past, but I always teach on it in bits and pieces or in parts. I did like one time when I first went into it pretty deep. It took a three-part series. Back then, YouTube wouldn't allow me to do any more than 15 minutes. So it took longer to bring it all out. And you know how it is. Somebody, they get the first part, then they forget. They don't go to the second part or whatever, and then they still wonder about it. Where now the YouTube lets us load as long as we want. 2 or 3 hours, we can still load it, which it doesn't take that long to go into it. But Revelation chapter 11, this is where, of course it's in Zechariah, but this is probably the main scripture that we all know when we think about the two witnesses. And we're going to, I'm a little dyslexic and I shouldn't confess that, but I'll take you on a roller coaster ride if you watch it. Has everybody in here watched YouTube and see that? So, I mean, as far as when I speak and stuff. I mean, is anybody here that does not know me at all that's here for the first time? All right, amen. God bless you. So, well, everybody else here will tell you, you know, you'll have to go back and watch it because I'll go this way and that way and this way and back that way.
But
and
you always come back to
me? Eventually. Amen. Amen. So it is a roller coaster ride, to say the least. And what happens is I get to thinking about other things at the same time. So in chapter 11, it says, "And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God, and the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out, and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. Now, Jesus also makes the comment, and I have to use Jesus a lot of times because some people don't understand the Yeshua part, but I like to use both because I prefer Yeshua. By the way, I learned something new from Nechami Gordon. He says when he was reading the Hebrew gospel that Matthew wrote it in, he said he actually writes it Yeshua, because I always have said Yeshua, but he says he actually wrote it Yeshua. So that was interesting. But anyhow, the thing is Yeshua actually tells us that Jerusalem would be trodden down by the Gentiles until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. That's just paraphrasing that. So we know that there is a time that they're to be trodden down for a duration of time, and then Israel would once again come back into their homeland. Now what's interesting, though, is when you read in Revelation, though, it seems kind of odd because now he's talking about only 3.5 years. That they're going to tread down the holy city. So, but if from the time of the destruction of the second temple, 70 AD, until now, the Gentiles are supposed to tread down the city to begin with, then who is he talking about? Well, if we look at the historical side of it, we had Babylon, we had Turkey, we had the British, have all been a part of Israel's history, and so therefore there's your Gentiles that have been ruling for all this time. Now we're coming down to a specific period of time, 3.5 years, where it's going to happen again. When I first began to look at this, it was quite a few years ago, and I was seeing how that they're wanting to make a two-state solution in Israel, and they want to make it with the Palestinians. I'm thinking, well, maybe it's the Palestinians, and then the Lord corrected me on that, and said it's not the Palestinians, it's Rome. So the two-state solution that you watch on television has absolutely nothing to do with anything. It's just a bluff. Daniel in chapter 11 says that they come up small, strong with a small people. The Palestinians are the small people that Rome comes up strong with. It's the excuse to get the control of Israel. Secondly, just to set the stage for you, 2,000 years ago, as Jewish people, and Sister Perez the same, Julie here, her family was there, my family was there, and it was our families that condemned him to death.
I don't think it's both the Gentiles.
The Romans did the dirty work. But we have to accept the responsibility because we were called to be a priestly nation. This was the reason why God gave Abraham the test. You know, when you think about, he tests Abraham. And I used to wonder that. What is a test? I don't get it. What is a test? I know it types, you know, God and Yeshua, and you know, he's willing to, you know, he's going to give up his only son. But that wasn't the test. He wanted to see if Abraham had it within his own heart to be able to offer up his own son totally blind to the reason why. Because he wanted to know if it was in his genes, if it was in his loins, to where his children, if they were blinded in the future, would have the same ability. We were chosen for a priestly nation. When we say we're a chosen people, it's not because we're better than the Gentiles. We're not. We were chosen for one purpose, and that was to offer up Jesus Christ as a sacrifice for the sins of the world. That's what we were chosen for. It was the hardest job you could ever imagine to have, our forefathers not knowing. And he had to blind our people, and yet he also promised there would always be a remnant, so some had to believe and the rest could not believe. That's why when Jesus was on the cross, Yeshua goes like this. He says, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And he clearly said to the Pharisees just before, not long before this all happened, he said, "If you were blind, you would have no sin." He said, "But you say you see. Therefore, your sin remains." Their sin remained. But what did they do? The Pharisees went around and they talked the Benjamites and the tribe of Judah to cry out for his blood. And it was all because of fear. They didn't really know. You know, I'm from the Levite family, so it's my own people that did that. But had we not done it, we wouldn't be here today. There would be no salvation. All hope would be lost. So it is for a reason. So anyway, Abraham, when he goes to offer him up, that's what God wanted to see. Did he have it in him? And when he saw that he had it in him to do it, then he allowed, I'm going to close this door here, then he allowed for that to happen. We were able then to be the priestly nation that could offer up the sacrifice of sin, for sin. Now, when it says here that they're going to tread down the city for 3.5 years, it's interesting because he talks about measuring the temple of God and the altar and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple, leave out and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. See, it's given to the Gentiles. This is not going to be that they come and fight and conquer Israel for it. We have to give it to them. And our country has already done that. When I was back in Israel, I don't know now, back during the Passover time, we were over there for a couple of months then. We went down to the Temple Institute. I wanted to talk to the rabbi down there, but I didn't get a chance to speak to him because I waited a little bit too long for it. But there was another rabbi that was there that was doing the tour, and I had a chance to speak to him afterwards because he made an interesting comment during the tour that really blew me away. He said, "We do not have control of Jerusalem. Israel doesn't have control of Jerusalem. Then who has control of Jerusalem if Israel doesn't have control of Jerusalem?" In 1993, Shimon Peres sold us out to the Vatican. You can go back and look at history for that. Barry Chamesh was the one that actually broke that story, and Barry has to live in the United States now. His family is still in Israel, but he is here because they kept trying to kill him. Luckily, they didn't succeed. And Barry, he's a tough guy, but anyway, so they give him that, and they tread down, and of course they're given the holy city. The holy city goes outside the walls of Jerusalem, the modern day, where the Turks built the walls around there. And so, but the old city goes outside of that in an area that's called East Jerusalem. It also encompasses Mount Zion. If they were to start digging up over there, we would find that we'd have even more ruins there as well. Well, oddly enough, the Vatican here recently goes over there, and the Pope comes there, and there's been a big dispute over whether or not Rome would be allowed to have the upper room, and they would get all of that area there, and it would be handed over to the Roman Catholic Church. And of course, the rabbi there refused to do it. He says, no, we're not doing this. This is the tomb of David is here. You've got the upper room above. That's fine. You can have that. And so we really thought that we were being able to stand our grounds. The Orthodox community came out. We did a huge protest against the Pope coming there. And that seemed to be pretty nice. And then all of a sudden, one day, they bring in Israeli special forces. And they threw the Jews out of the tomb of David, men and women, and they were all thrown out. And when they threw them out of the temple, out of King David's tomb, they proceeded to have a mass inside the tomb of David. I guess we do not have control of Jerusalem. Now, there's a very interesting passage. I'm going to just see if I have it marked here. And I'm just kind of, I want to set the stage a little bit for you. And the reason for this is because then it makes more sense about the two witnesses. In Obadiah is where I'd like to take you. I still cannot get used to a Christian Bible layout. What's that? What's it by?
Amos.
Ah, thank you. I know it's only one chapter, but... Yes, it's ran by the Vatican.
Does that mean they own it?
According to several writers, including Giulio Miotti, who writes for Israel's National News. You can see Giulio Miotti all the time. He is an Italian journalist that writes for Israel. He's not Jewish. He is a Christian believer, but he writes for our newspaper. I know Giulio personally. I know Barry Chamesh personally. And there are several others that also have written about these things. Both of these men are investigative journalists, so their sources are, they can corroborate all the information here. But they will both tell you that Israel does not have control of Jerusalem. 60% of Israel, or excuse me, of Jerusalem is under the control of the Vatican. And by the way, the Vatican actually came down, and this has been some years ago, but they came to the leading rabbis that were over, because we have different rabbis over different things. We have a rabbi over the Kotel, the Wailing Wall, as you call it. We have the rabbi that is over the King David's tomb. And then just all different places we have rabbis over different things. And so the rabbis came together. They had a meeting with several of the head archbishops from the Vatican, and they had a private meeting, closed door. But these rabbis revealed when they came out of the meeting that they were told point blank that if we did not hand over back to Rome some of the certain properties that they had prior to Israel coming back and taking the country back in 1948, that they would not, quote unquote, guarantee the safety of their families. Vatican's got some audacity. Exactly. I believe it's verse 13 here. Thou shouldest not have entered into the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. The people that entered into Israel during the day of the calamity was in 70 AD were the Romans. Yea, thou shouldest not have looked on their affliction in the day of their calamity, nor have laid hands on their substance in the day of their calamity. We know for a fact now that it's Rome, because they got this nice, big, pretty thing called the Ark of Titus in Rome. And they have, of course, Titus, the Roman general, his little picture up there, and they're carrying the menorah and all the other temple treasures that they could possibly find at that time. They're carrying them to Rome, and according to Gershon Solomon, a friend of mine that's over the temple and Faithful Mount Institute. I never can get that right. It's too long of a title. Gershon, please change that. No, forgive me. I love that brother very dearly. But anyway, Gershon said he has actual friends that have been in the catacombs that have actually seen the menorah, and it is there. I think they do that intentionally just to tease the politicians of Israel to get them to do what they want. But anyway, he said it is there. So and God says it's there as well. He says, nor have laid hands on their substance in the day of their calamity. Neither shouldest thou have stood in the crossway to cut off those that did escape. Neither shouldest thou have delivered up those of his that did remain in the day of distress. All these things happened. And that's what Titus did. All the way down to Masada, in fact. He didn't let anybody escape. If he could block it, he blocked it, and he killed every Jew he possibly could. For the day of the Lord is near upon the heathen, or the nations in this case. As thou hast done, it shall be done unto thee. Thy reward shall return upon thine own head. It's important you understand that, because that's what Revelation 11 is all about. For as you have drunk upon my holy mountain, so shall all the heathen drink continually. There's your clue right there. You just got to see about 3 weeks ago now that verse fulfilled. When they had communion in King David's tomb, they fulfilled. He said, you've drunk on my holy mountain. Now some people might say, well, that was when they went in the temple and they disgraced the temple and did that. It's not talking about that, because look what he says. For the day of the Lord is near upon all the heathen. As thou hast done, it shall be done unto thee. God swore that he would pay Rome back for what they did to Israel and all the other nations, including during the time of the pogroms, the time of the Holocaust, the time of the Inquisition, all the different peoples that have been involved in that. He's going to pay them back. That's why he brings all the nations down to Jerusalem. So this is a future date. That's why he's talking about that. For the day of the Lord is near. For you have drunk upon my holy mountain, so shall they all drink, and they shall swallow down, and they shall be as though they had not been, but upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance. Now you know the location. It's Mount Zion. See, the temple is not on Mount Zion. The temple is on Mount Moriah. That's how we know that this was just fulfilled. So the thing is God is intending to bring judgment, and so the question is how is he planning on bringing judgment? So we go back to Revelation 11, and we read here, it says, but the court, okay, we read that, verse 3, and I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. Now, we know that he's referring now back to Zechariah's prophecy. Now, in one simple nutshell, but I'm going to give you plenty of them, I could solve the mystery of the two witnesses by that verse alone. There are the two candlesticks that stand, or the two olive trees on either side of the golden lampstand. Does anybody remember who the golden lampstand is, according to Revelation?
Christ.
Exactly. And it says that they're standing on either side. Does anybody remember Mount Transfiguration? The two olive trees were standing on either side of the golden lampstand that stood in the middle. And that right there should settle it. But it doesn't for everybody, so let's go a little deeper and let's really give everybody a hard time that gets to watch the video. See, when I'm wore out and tired, I really have a lot more fun. And I got somebody to look at besides just looking at that camera all the time. See, when I'm talking to you guys and y'all are listening, I have no idea who's out there listening. I'm looking at that little square box. And then I get sidetracked. Y'all probably see it. My eyes are just a little bit off. I'm looking at the monitor and saying, oh my, that's right. They don't see them. I got to look at the lens. You know, and then you don't want to look like you're just staring like some of the news commentators, you know. So you're trying to like, it's terrible. It's so nice to get to talk to you guys in person. All right, so the two candlesticks. So we know now that it was Moses and Elijah on Mount Transfiguration, and Yeshua, he is Mashiach, he is Christ, that golden candlestick. And it was Moses and Elijah on either side. So we know that neither one of them are dead. But here comes the thing that a lot of people have trouble with. They take the scripture that says, it is appointed once for man to die, and after this, the judgment. You should really take a good look at that Greek word there, appointed. It's not an absolute. And even, here's the thing, and keep this in mind. It's, in other words, Paul is saying, you're supposed to die at least one time. But if we took it literal the way Paul said, it's appointed one man wants to die, then after this the judgment, then what about Lazarus? Why does he got to die twice? See, because this is really the argument about Moses. Moses is already dead. These guys didn't die. Does anybody here believe in a rapture? I'm not worried about if it's pre, trib, mid, all that kind of stuff. Okay. When are y'all going to die? I mean, if Paul's word is either, if it's literal and it means it's an absolute, you got to come back and die after you go up. So see, and even the people that normally, I think post-trib is like, it's not really you believe in a rapture, it's just the fact that you know that when the end comes, then we which are alive and remain, we don't die, we just get to go up. So we never die. So even the people that don't believe in the rapture, they at least believe that. And so they still got a problem. You got a lot of folks that'll be living. Now, we say a lot compared to probably what's left over. Who knows what's going in the rapture? Is it 100? Is it 1,000? Is it 1,000,000? Is it 2,000,000? I don't know. I don't think they're all going naked. I mean, I always see these movies. They show their clothes left behind. I said that was the funniest thing I ever saw. First time I saw that Left Behind movie, and all of a sudden they disappear and they're grabbing their clothes, and I'm laughing. I said, now that is, God's got to have a sense of humor to take you back naked. So.
I always thought it was like taking you in your spirit.
I know, but, you know, it's just the humor of it to think about it, you know. I'm sure that's what it is. He's taking the spirit. But he takes the body, so maybe he just changes their clothes for them, you know. That's something interesting. Just mention that we mentioned clothes. Let me tell you something. You know how the Bible says they both realized they were naked?
After,
in the Garden of Eden, after the sin, right? But do you know they were actually clothed?
Yeah, with the Shekinah glory.
That's it.
Right.
They were clothed
exactly.
With the Shekinah glory. So therefore, when the Shekinah was all around them, it's like when people talk about they see Yeshua in vision or in dreams, and sometimes they say that it's just like a beautiful light, but they know he's there. That's the way it was. I saw that. It's one of the most powerful things that really convinced me that Yeshua was the Messiah, was I saw him in vision. I was wide awake, and he knocked on the door of my house. I'm thinking I'm still wide awake, but I was wide awake. All I did was just sit on the edge of the bed, and I hear this. And I'm like, go answer the door. And I walked down the hallway and opened the door, and there he was. And it was just like that light. And you want to talk about scare somebody, that scared me really bad. And then he told me, he said, man hears more often than he listens. And see, what it was is I was really reading the Bible a lot, but I wasn't living what I was reading. I was only 18 years old. And I'd given my heart to the Lord at like 7 or 8 years old. My mother, being a Jewish girl, she visited the Baptist church with a girlfriend of hers, and that's all it took for me. I heard that guy preach about salvation, and do you want to be saved as London Baptist Church in Castleberry, Alabama. In fact, before we started this trip here, I passed it. Actually, after we left Houston, I came past there, and I went up there, and I left them a little note to thank them. I said, I want to thank whoever the pastor was at that time. That what he did. I said, because if it hadn't have been for that, who knows where I'd be today. So anyway, so we kind of look at that and we realize that the idea that you must die does not necessarily pertain. Now let's look at another thing before I really start breaking down the two witnesses. Do you guys remember where, I believe it's Gabriel that has an argument, or Satan has an argument with Gabriel about the body of Moses? Do any of you guys know why?
Couldn't find it.
Julie, you can't answer that because you probably know.
Maybe it doesn't have a clue.
Oh, no, good. You never saw that video. The Lord revealed to me why. And it's so obvious, but it's funny. Nobody ever thought about it.
Oh, because he can't be two witnesses, right?
No, he never saw corruption. You have to understand, Satan studied the Torah. When Moses wrote the Torah, and the prophets had wrote the Navim and the Kotavim, which is the prophets and the writings, he had all of that. He had David's writings. He had Jeremiah's writings. He had all this. And Satan was studying it. He was right over the shoulder of some rabbi going, whoa, okay. And he's trying to figure out God's plan because he wants to derail what God has intended for us. And so he's searching, and he's trying to figure it out. One thing that he knew that the Word said, I will not suffer my Holy One to see corruption. And he knew that applied to the Messiah. And when Moses, when he steps up on the rock, he dies. The Bible said he died, but there's, and it says his burial place is unmarked, unknown, but his body never saw corruption. And Satan was irritated. He's the angel of death. He's the one that when you die, he's allowed to get that body. And there was no body for him to get. And that troubled him. Because it didn't really match the rest of the scripture, but it matched a lot of the scriptures of what the, who the Messiah should be. And when you look at Moses' life, his life even types out the life of the Messiah. It's really interesting. I've never done a video on that yet, but I need to do one. Just how, like Joseph and like David, they all type out Yeshua beautifully. And Moses does too, but there's a lot of things that people just don't know about that. And this is one of the key things, that he doesn't see corruption. And everything was hunky-dory. And Satan didn't have a problem with that. He probably just figured, I got your anointed one. But he didn't get the body, and that just kind of confused him. But he didn't want to let God know. I mean, I'm just hypothetically thinking about this, but I don't think he wanted God to know that it troubled him. But what really caused the trouble is when Yeshua come. And we know that Satan wasn't for sure if he was the Messiah, because in the wilderness journey for 40 years, or 40 days when he's in that wilderness being tempted, he says, if thou be the Son of God, cast yourself down from off this pinnacle. For it's written, behold, it's written, the angels there to bear thee up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. See, he's quoting the word of God. And believe me, that's where the devil is today. He will quote that word, but he can't keep it. But he can sure quote it. And he can misquote it. And he can mistranslate it. And he can cause all kinds of problems, but he's not going to live it. And so, he does all these things to Yeshua because he's not certain. He's not persuaded that he is indeed the Messiah. And so when he's actually taken and he goes to Calvary and he's hung on the cross and he's dying there, he's still not sure. It wasn't until after his spirit left that body that he knew then that that was the Messiah. And then what really threw him for a loop, it wasn't just the fact that he died, because he saw his body go into the tomb. But then the big clincher for Satan that threw him off was he rises up before corruption could set in, just like Moses. And he did not know what to do with that. That drove him insane. Because he didn't get to see the rest of the picture yet. So it drove him crazy. And by the way, a little interesting thought too. You know, the Bible says that Yeshua was tempted in all manners such as we are. I was thinking about this recently. When he goes to the 40 days in the wilderness to be tempted of the devil, if you look back what he went through, do you know that's the same thing the Jews went through for the 40 years during their journey in the wilderness? I think when he said he was tempted in all manners such as you were, he was going through what Israel went through during that 40 years. Just a thought. So anyway, we go into this part here. We see that as far as the two witnesses, we read here, it says that after we get the part about that there are the two olive trees. In verse 5 says, if any man will hurt them, fire proceeded out of their mouth and devour their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. I saw a movie, they showed that, and a guy opens his mouth and fire comes out and burns him up like a dragon. I don't think that's what he's talking about. I believe what it's talking about is like Elijah when he's sitting up on top of the hill, and the soldiers that come up first time, the irreverent ones, they said, you know, you're commanded to come down here to the king. He says, if I be a man of God, he'll let the fire come down out of heaven and consume you all. And it did. I believe that's what he's talking about when he says fire will consume their enemies. In fact, this may have a lot to do with the enemies that come against Israel. That might be one of the ways that God is dealing with Israel's enemies. So take away our bombs if you want to. Maybe that's what God is trying to do with us now. It's like in the days of Joshua, you know, he goes down, he's got so many men with him, and God says, you got too much, go have them go down to the water here, and the ones that drink the water, see which ones kneel down and scoop it up with their hands, the ones that bow down. The ones that bow down, get rid of them, they've all been bowing to idols, don't eat them no way.
Was that Gideon?
Sorry. Thank you. God bless somebody and get me right. So Gideon in this case here. But what happens in the battle, though? He gets it down to where it's only, what, 300? 300 people. And they go take on this huge army. Maybe God's trying to do that with us today. Maybe we don't need all of it. We don't need our nuclear weapons. We don't need all the other stuff, because God will take two little old witnesses, send them in there, and defeat the world with them. And we know it brings the world to their knees, because the Bible says the whole world rejoices at their death. And that's also the time that God will destroy the Vatican. Because the Bible says, when he gives the promise to her, he says, you will be destroyed when the world rejoices. I wish I had all that marked down for you. You guys would have a field day with that. So anyway, that's where we can see Elijah's type of ministry there, the fire. These have power to shut the heaven that it rain not in the days of their ministry. Again, like Elijah. Turn the waters to turn them to blood, like Moses. And that's one reason why some people believe it's Moses. Here's the next thing that's very interesting. And to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will, and when they shall finish their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them and kill them, and their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified, which is right outside the Damascus Gate. It's a Palestinian bus station there, so I'm sure they'll take part in this. But the thing is the plagues. That's why it also calls it spiritually Sodom and Egypt. Because Moses was dealing with Pharaoh in Egypt. So it's spiritually called Egypt. Now, the Pharaoh, this is another interesting thing, and it brings out your two witnesses, and it also brings out who Pharaoh has, or who the two witnesses are going to have to deal with. It's got to be the Antichrist. The Pharaoh of Egypt believed that he was God on earth. That's what he said he was. He also worshipped the sun god and the moon god. Now, I know there's some people that can go into that a whole lot better than I can. In fact, we're looking at doing a conference possibly January or February. I've got several brothers that we'll be bringing in that are really good on this part here. And we're looking at doing it here in Atlanta somewhere. So, Alan Lamont from England, we're going to try to get him over as well. He's very good on these things. But the thing is, so if I bring up the Pharaoh, and you'll understand why in just a minute. If the Pharaoh of Egypt was God on earth, and God is now saying that they're going to be killed in an area that is called spiritually Sodom and Egypt, Sodom represents the conditions of Jerusalem, of Israel. It's become like Sodom was. And that's the disgrace to our country now. We already have gay parades, and even our politicians are saying that at least here we're the only democratic country in the Middle East. And it's true, we're the only democratic country, and this is what causes all of our problems. This is why, and he says, here you can be gay and nothing happened to you. No wonder why he says Sodom. Makes sense now. Now, but I stress the part about Pharaoh, because now we're going to go to Exodus 15. Let me use a Jewish Bible for this. Sister Julie, that's in Shemot. By the way, when we say Shemot in Hebrew, it doesn't mean Exodus. It doesn't mean coming out. Shemot means the names. Okay. In chapter 15, in the very beginning, I'm going to read it to you in Hebrew. That way we can put some emphasis on what is actually said here. It says, Az Yashir Moshe Uvene Yisrael et Hashemayim, excuse me, et Hashira, Hazot Ladonai Veyomru Lemor. Ha Isha. Ladonai. That's God's divine name, but as Jews we don't pronounce his name. Ki ga'a go'o. Sus v'rekevo ramam b'yom. Now, let's look at it in English. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song to the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider has he thrown into the sea. Now, it's a little different in King James. I know that as far as what you're reading there. But the point is, though, that we want to make here is that Moses sings a song. In English, the way you see it, it is future. I will sing. But in Hebrew, the way we futurize a word is a little different than what you do in English. You would think, okay, they just came through the Red Sea. Pharaoh and his army and 600 chariots and all these riders and stuff, they all got swallowed up by the sea and they're all dead now, and now they're going to sing. But that's not what he says in Hebrew. He says, Asherah. Asherah. Because see, first he tells the people like he's going to teach them a song. Because it says, Az Yashir Moshe. See? Then sang Moses, Uvane Yisrael et Hashira, and the children of Israel, this song. And they and to the Lord, and spoke, saying, see, they are saying the song, but the song starts out as one person only. Az Yashir, excuse me, not Az Yashir, Ashira is not the whole group. The song is being sung about Moses. I will sing, for he sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider are hurled into the sea. It's not 600. It's only one. One horse, one rider. Now, what's kind of ironic about that, in Revelation, you have four horses. But it appears to be the same guy that rides the first horse rides the other three. So if he has to get off the first one and get on the second and then the third and then the fourth one, then there's only going to be one horse and one rider. Now, Pharaoh is typed as the Antichrist of Moses' day. And Moses says he's going to come back. And this is really what he's saying. I'm going to come back and sing the song. Now, this is not just Brother Steve making this up. In the Midrash, Rashi, the great Hebraic scholar from about 1,000 years ago, and of course Ibn Ezra and several other rabbis, as they've looked at this scripture, they realize Moses is singing about a future redemption of Israel. A day when a Pharaoh would be again over the children of Israel. And that they're going to be redeemed, and that the children of Israel will sing a song of redemption that Pharaoh, this man who claims to be God on earth, will be defeated and he will be cast into a sea. And Rashi actually says, I think it's Rashi, maybe it was Ibn Ezra that made this other comment, I forget which one made this comment. No doubt this must be during the Messianic time. In other words, when the Messiah comes. Oh, this one's upside down. Sorry. Let's go to Revelation 15. So, if this be so, we're actually getting a clue about Moses already. If this is really true, Moses doesn't say, some other guy is going to sing. He personalizes it. And he says, I will sing unto the Lord that they have gotten victory over the horse and over his rider. In Revelation chapter 15, it's kind of ironic that it's a corresponding chapter. And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. Seven angels having this in them, excuse me, seven angels having the seven last plagues. For in them is filled up the wrath of God. And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire. Seems like Israel always gets caught in front of seas. I know you guys are probably thinking only the Red Sea. You know, we do have a prophecy in Jeremiah chapter 23 and also in chapter 16 that says we would no longer say the Lord lives that delivered the children of Israel from Egypt, but we would say the Lord lives that has delivered the house of Israel, not the children of Israel, but the house of Israel from the land of the north and all other countries where they've been driven. I remember talking to Dr. Chuck Missler, and I asked him, I said, why would he separate the land of the north from all other countries? And I said, isn't it ironic? He refers to the Exodus. He says we're going to have another Exodus that's going to seem to overshadow or make the original Exodus not talked about as much as this next Exodus. And yet during the war, when the Germans were killing off the Jews, Hitler decided that he wanted to go take Moscow as well. And he needed a staging area to do it with. Well, he'd already been taken over all of the countries, Poland, everything else had already been just decimated by his forces. But then he goes into Belarus at the time, and he began to annihilate the Jews there. Part of my family's from Belarus. But you guys got to see a movie, if you did. Anybody ever see the movie Defiance? Okay. The movie Defiance, Daniel Craig plays a heroine called Tuvia Bielski. And Ed Zwick plays his brother. And the beautiful thing about this movie is that they too are evading a force. They move around even in the wilderness, if I'm not mistaken, they moved around the exact same number of times that Moses moved from the time he left Egypt, the encampments that he made before he ended up at the Red Sea or the Gulf of Aqaba in modern day Egypt, at the border of Egypt and Saudi Arabia, where they found chariot wheels on the seafloor there. But he ends up moving around the same amount of times. And then the next thing they know, the Germans, when they finally decided that they got to put an end to the Russian partisans and to get rid of the Jews that were hiding in the forest, and Tuvia and his brothers had rescued 1,200 Jews and were hiding them in that wilderness. That's a lot of Jews to hide in one place. And so what happens, he sends in 50,000 soldiers to go through the Nalibak forest in Belarus and to kill every Jew and every Russian partisan there was. There happened to be a swamp in this forest, and there was one island in the middle of that swamp, and that island was 8.5 miles to get to. And Tuvia took his men and took all those Jews, women and children included. They crossed 8.5 miles to elude the Germans. Now, the reason why this matters is because in Hebrew, Moses doesn't call the Red Sea, Red Sea. He calls it Yam Suf, which means a sea of reeds. And when he crossed the Gulf of Aqaba, there are no reeds on the Red Sea. There's never historically or anything else ever been proven that there was any reeds there whatsoever. So I'm sure they had to scratch their heads and say, why would he call it a sea of reeds? I mean, the Jews are going down there, sea of reeds. Okay, Moses, and we're following this guy. But he was prophesying. Unbeknownst to him, maybe. But he was prophesying of a future event that Jeremiah records, that the day will come, they will not speak of this Exodus, but they will speak of the one where they come from, the land of the north. Belarus, it's considered the land of the north. They crossed 8.5 miles at the place of Gulf of Aqaba where they found the chariot wheels. It's 8.5 miles across as well. Tuvia Bielski took those Jews across 8.5 miles of reeds, a Yam Suf. So now you saw the picture in there. That was actually filmed in Lithuania, same forest. Different part of the swamp was all. So anyway, all right, so we get over here to Revelation. And he says here, verse 16, and he that sat on the, And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name stand on the sea of glass having harps of God, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God. Wow. Moses says that he's going to sing in the future the song of redemption. And this says here that they got the victory over the beast, over his image, over his mark, the number of his name. Anybody know what that is? Do they have a marker in this room? I don't guess so. Ooh, I've got one somewhere. I wish I had one. If my wife was in here, is she still here? I saw her a second ago. I do have one. I'll have her bring one in a little bit. I'll show you. I mean, there's all kinds of things. People say the 666 is this, that, and that, and everything. I don't know. They probably make Coca-Cola into 666, give them enough time. But the one that seems the most plausible to me is what's written on, or actually written on the crown of the Pope. It's in Latin. It says Vicarius Filii Dei. It literally means in English, in the stead or in the place of the Son of God. He claims to be God on earth, is what he claims. When you take that name and you take the Roman numerals, because it's written in Latin, and so certain letters are Roman numerals. The rest of the letters have no value at all as far as in numbers. It adds up 666. You can do it backwards, forwards, frontwards, sideways, upside down, any way you want to do it. It's still going to add up the same way every time. So anyway, so it says they got the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. So they're getting ready to do an exodus. They're on a sea of glass. And they sing the song of Moses. Now notice the sea of glass is mingled with fire, if I remembered right. I forget where I saw that. I know I see that somewhere, though. And I think it's because they're being like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I think God is taking them through the judgments that's actually falling at that point. That's just a conjecture. I can't say that's right. They sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Why would it say they sing the song of the Lamb? Well, you would think if this was applying to just Christians and everything, they already know who Jesus is if they got stuck in tribulation. They've learned the song of Moses. Why? Because he came back as one of the two witnesses. In fact, the Bible says when their dead bodies, when they're killed and they're laying in the street, it says the remnant were affrighted, but they gave glory unto God. That's why you don't see Moses in Revelation 15. He's not with them, but he taught them the song. That's how they know to sing the song of Moses. He's not there, but he taught them. And it says, and the song of the Lamb. Why? Because these must have some Jews amongst these people, and they believe that Yeshua is the Messiah. That's why they sing the song of the Lamb. Because they know now that the Lamb of God is what redeemed them. Now we're going to get deep into it. I better use a Jewish Bible for that one. Now, I'm mainly working on Moses, but we're going to go into Elijah as well. Let's go to Exodus chapter 3. I think that's right. Oh, yes, that's where I got all my notes at. A lot of things happen when God comes and reveals himself to Moses. A lot of things that are very interesting that he says here. We're going to go to verse 13. I'm going to, a little bit of Hebrew, a little bit of English at the same time. And there's a reason behind that. I'll explain it as I go. Ve'yomer Moshe el ha'elohim. And Moses said to God, Hine anochi bo. Oh, wait a minute. I do want to go back a little bit further. Hang on. No, it doesn't matter. I mean, we already know what it is Moses, just for the background purpose, we know that what happens, Moses, he has to leave Egypt. Well, no, you guys know. He was put in the basket by his mother, and Pharaoh's daughter sees him, has compassion on him. She knows he's Jewish, but she takes him in, raises him as her own son. He's taught in all the wisdom of Egypt. He is like a general, so to speak. There's even evidence. I know Dr. David Roll, who's a friend of mine as well. Dr. David Roll, he's an Egyptologist, historian. In fact, he is an unbeliever. He is Jewish, but he doesn't claim to believe in God. But his work is what put the Bible back, is the guideline for the timing of all the events that happen. And it really upset a lot of the other doctors. I'm not upset them as far as it wouldn't matter to them, but it upset their work. And he found the proofs. And so we come to find out that the Bible is actually accurate through his own works. And he still doesn't profess to believe in God. But he did a remarkable job on that. But anyway, though, the whole idea, though, was that Moses, he says in some of his work that he did that Moses was obviously a general, and he talks about some of the battles that he actually does. So we can see from that Moses indeed was a military commander. We also see that when he goes to deliver Israel, how he lines them up in lines and things like that. He does things very much like a military leader, which oddly enough, Tuvia Bielski was the same way. Michael Bielski, Tuvia's son, is one of my dearest friends, so I got to learn a lot of the inside things about the family and what they went through. But anyway, so we don't waste a lot of time on these things here. So we know the story of Moses. He gets thrown out of Egypt, doesn't get thrown out of Egypt. He has to flee for his life. And when he does, we know he goes into Midian, which is actually northwest Saudi Arabia. There's a lot of research that's been done on that, and I'm very much convinced myself. I actually discovered the mountain where God came and sat down on in Saudi Arabia across the Red Sea there, that the entire mountain had been burnt on the opposite side, and no one had ever noticed that before. And when I discovered that mountain there, it really blew some of the researchers away. And I said, it's only obvious if he came down on Mount Sinai and the mountain there is burnt and the rocks are scorched, then why not when he came down in part of the Red Sea with a blast of his nostrils? And sure enough, dead due east, the mountain sitting directly in the back, and there's a picture of it. I don't think I have it on my website. That was taken by Ron Wyatt's, his wife is still living, but Ron Wyatt's wife took that picture. And you can see the mountain burnt. And nobody ever noticed that, though, where God had come down, the Shekinah glory, and it just burnt the top of that mountain. But anyway, the point that we want to get here, though, is he goes down in there. He meets his wife there, Zipporah. And we'll come back to that story on the second part of the meeting tonight, if you're able to stay, because it's very interesting what happens in that. But finally, God, he meets God on the backside of the desert. God comes down in the Shekinah glory, as we would call it as Jews, the pillar of fire that I think Christians call that as a general rule. And it's a burning bush. Now, I think you read in the Christian Bible, it was the angel of his presence or the angel of the Lord, something like that, that speaks about it. But if you read it in Hebrew and in English as well, you have capital L-O-R-D, the Lord spoke from the midst of the bush. Now, the Shekinah that's there, the pillar of fire, when it talks about the angel of the Lord, it's not like some guy separate standing there. That pillar of fire is the angel of the Lord. It is the form in which God has taken upon himself. Like when we see that the three strangers that go before Abraham, it calls them messengers, or in Hebrew, it calls them angels. But it's not like angels with wings. And yet, Moses said writes about the one that stayed behind with Abraham, he wrote Yod Heh Vav Heh, which is God's divine name, that's who that was. So God can be a man. So if you ever have a Jew, like Some of the rabbis I know, Rabbi Tovia Singer for one, they will argue that God cannot become, he cannot be a man. And that argument amongst the Jews is because we're trying to disprove that Yeshua could be, that he could not be a man, and he can't have a son. But what happened with Abraham proves all that is wrong, because God did become a man and walked in a human body and ate, and he broke the kosher law according to the rabbis, because he ate the lamb and drank the milk from the lamb as well, which breaks up all of our traditions. So I don't believe in that type. I do keep kosher, but I don't. That's not the type of kosher that I keep. I keep what God's word says is kosher. And I don't say that you have to. That's Brother Steve does that. So anyway, God has come down. He meets him at the burning bush. And it starts off, we'll back up just a little bit. Let's go to verse 8. I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of Egypt, and to bring them up out of that land to a good land, and a large land flowing with milk and honey, to a place of the Canaanite. I don't know how you guys say that, Canaanite maybe, and the Hittite, and the Emori, and the Perizzi, and the Hivi, and the Uvisi, and I think that's Hittite, Amorite, might be in King James. Behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee to Pharaoh, and thou mayest bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token to thee that I have sent you. When thou hast brought the people of Egypt, brought out the people of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain. And Moses said to God, behold, when I come to the children of Israel, and shall say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, they shall say to me, what is his name? This is interesting. So in Hebrew we say, Ve'yomer Moshe el ha'elohim hene anochi bo, El Bnei Yisrael. So behold, when I come to the children of Israel, Amori lechem, and say to them, Elohai avotechem, the God of your father, Shelachani Eliachem, has sent me unto you. Amru li, they will say unto me, Ma Shemo. What is his name? Now, we always read that and just read right over it, not realizing what's written there. Now, he answers him, Ihaye Asha Ihaye. This is what you will tell them. Ihaye Asha Ihaye is not a name. His name is spelled Yod He Vav He, not Yod He Yod. And in this case, he said, Ihaye Aleph Yod He Yod. It's spelled differently. Why? Because this, literally, you have in your Bible, I am that I am. Literally, he says, I will be that which I am. When Yeshua came on the earth, what does Yeshua say? Except that you believe that I am. And you have he in italics. You will die in your sins. So when God says there, I will prove that which I am, or I will be that which I am, he is expressing who he's going to be by what he does. Now, later, God does tell Moses his name. He said, I was not known by my name, and for the sake of those that listen, we have all different variations from Jehovah, Yahweh, Yehovah, Yahweh, all the different variations. For Jews, we don't say it because it says, take not the Lord thy God's name in vain. So if we figure we don't know how to say it, then we figure it's safer to say Hashem, which means the name. And if you have the definite article in Hebrew, hey, in front of the word name, it can apply to anyone else whatsoever. And I'll explain that in a minute so it makes more sense to you. Now, some people argue, no, we shouldn't know how to pronounce the name because they were saying it up until the times of Jesus' day. In fact, the first rabbi that they burned to death in 126 after A.D., they burned him at the stake, wrapped him up in Torah scrolls, and burned him for saying God's divine name. And that's when the Jewish rabbis decided we would no longer say his name. And then they changed some vowels around to prevent us from saying it correctly. And over time, apparently, it was lost. Now, some people might argue and say, well, that can't be. So let's just settle that real quick. There's more than one place in this in Scripture on it. Let's just real quick look at Zephaniah. And I'm doing this for a reason, because we got to come back to where Moses asked God the question. He says, they will ask me, what is your name?
Which one?
We're going to go to Zephaniah. That is near Zechariah, I know, in the King James. I'm used to that one. Somewhere right in that area, I think. Well, I thought I knew where that one was, too. I guess I don't. Anybody get to it yet? Whereabouts is that at? Oh, you're cheating, brother. You can't see which book?
Jewish Bible.
Oh, it's right by Habakkuk? Right after Habakkuk. And what's Habakkuk after? Oh, there we go. Here we go. Zephaniah. Okay, let's go to chapter 3. Let's start with verse 8. Therefore, it's very critical, these next three words. Therefore, wait ye upon me, saith the Lord. Now, if God's asking you to wait, he wants you to wait. He doesn't want you to get ahead of it. Just wait. Until the day that I arise up to the prey, for my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms, that I may, to pour upon them mine indignation, even all my fierce anger, for all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. By the way, if you ever wonder what the seventh seal is, the silence in heaven for the space of a half an hour, and what is it? That's it right there. Now you might say, how do you know that? The Bible said there was silence in heaven for the space of a half an hour. How could you know that? Because it also says in the Tanakh, it says, let everything keep still. Let everything hold silent. For he has risen up out of his holy habitation. You didn't know that one, did you? Somebody please look that up. If anybody got a way to look it up, I'll find it for you before the night's out. That's how we know what the seventh seal is. When God commands everything to hold still is when he raises up out of his holy habitation, and it's to come to redeem Israel. I have a feeling it has to do with your rapture as well. And the reason I say that, and I know somebody, I said something one time and they said, oh gosh, Brother Steve, I thought you was a pre-tribber, sure enough. And I can't believe you just said that. And I said, I'm for whenever he wants to come, tribber. I don't care if it's 20 years before that time. I said, all I can tell you is what he writes in his word. I said, I'm not going to add to it. You know, and personally, if you want to know the truth, I don't think it's mid, pre, or post. I think he's going to throw everybody off. He might come a week into it. He might come a year into it. Isn't it funny? Joseph reveals himself to his brethren 2 years into that famine. But you can't say that's the rapture either. You now come because his wife is not there. During the famine of Joseph in Genesis, yeah. When you look at that, there were 7 years of plenty, 7 years of famine.
Right.
Okay? That's kind of interesting. We have plenty right now. But anyway, you get to the 7 years of famine, and his brothers come down to buy corn. When he finally reveals himself to them, he says there are yet 5 years of famine left. So it was 2 years after it started. Now that's not talking about the bride. That's just talking about him revealing himself to his brethren. It's only a type. Okay? But who is the type of the bride in that picture? Joseph's wife. Where was she when he revealed himself to his brethren? Not there. Because when it doesn't even say she was there when the Egyptians were there, the people of notoriety that were inside there when he reveals himself to his brethren, because he dismisses every Gentile out of his presence.
When he revealed himself, do you think he revealed his circumcision?
No.
You don't think that's...
All he had to do was say who he was. Their eyes were just held. They just couldn't see who he was. God had blinded them just like they did with the Jews of today. We were blinded.
And so I wonder, the believing Jews, do they rapture? Do they stay?
That's a good question. I would say this.
I have absolutely no opinion on when I'm going to be raptured.
Yeah. I believe that the believing Jews will go on a rapture that believe prior to him revealing himself to them. And I'll tell you why. When John saw the number that no man could number, and the Bible says they were made up of every kindred, tongue, nation, and tribe. We are the 12 tribes. He wasn't talking about the Apaches.
That's
true. Okay? He's talking about Israel. That's why he knows it's tribes. But the ones that were sealed, he knew who they were because it's his own people. So anyway, it was 2 years into the famine, he reveals himself to them. But here's the other thing that blows your mind away. And this is why I say, I can't say when the rapture is, because the thing is, I don't know when he reveals himself to Israel. I mean, Joseph is just a little clue into it, 2 years. But that doesn't mean that that's the way he does it this time. But I'll give you another clue in the Bible about when the bride goes up. You will see Israel. You will see her believe. If it's only for a second, you will see it. Now, Joseph's wife heard it. The Bible said that all the way into Pharaoh's house, they could hear the mourning and weeping as Joseph revealed himself to his brothers. The people at the marriage supper will hear the weeping and mourning of Israel.
You think that's what's that word you keep saying? The time of the Gentiles?
I'm not sure about that one. We'll come back to that though. The story of Boaz is another big clue for you guys. Mm-hmm. Boaz, as you guys know, is a type of Mashiach. He's a type of Christ. Now, there's so many things, there's so many depths to the story of Boaz, it's not even funny. But Boaz, when he comes and he finds Ruth, and it's funny, Ruth, you can see the faith in her. She tells her mother, I'm going to the field to the glean in whom I will find favor in his sight. She's got faith. She knows she's going to find favor in Boaz. But she's not even a Jew. How's she going to find favor? She goes and she gleans from the four corners of the field according to the law of Moses. You know why Moses gave us this law? It's only to be gleaned by the strangers or the Gentiles and the poor. Because God knew that he would scatter Israel to the four corners of the earth. He would scatter us to the four corners of the earth. So therefore, what God does as a type, he's showing you that the Gentiles would be the ones that would help bring Israel back to their homeland. What does he say? What did he say? This is what's so beautiful. What does he say to Ruth when he meets her? He asks his reapers, who is this girl? Who is she? They said, this is Ruth the Moabite, Naomi's daughter-in-law. And when he goes to her, he tells her, stay. Reap, just go ahead and reap amongst my own reapers here. He said, it's been told to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law. So I can guarantee you another thing. Everybody that makes the rapture has a heart for the Jews. Because she is a type of the bride. Because she's the one that marries Boaz. She is the Gentile that ends up becoming the bride. And he is attracted to her because of her love of her mother-in-law. That's something to think about, not to mention the gleaning from the four corners. So anyway, we didn't finish Zephaniah though. Let's go back. Therefore wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey. For my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms, to pour upon them mine indignation, even all my fierce anger. For all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. For then I will turn to the people a pure language. When's he going to turn a pure language to the people? When those nations are gathered against Israel and he rises up. That they may all call upon the name of the Lord, which in your Bible, all caps, L-O-R-D, which means his divine name. So you won't know for sure how to say his name until he restores. He said he has to restore a pure language so that they can call upon his name. So all these fancy scholars out there that say, well, we know what it means. Even Nehemiah, I love him. I know Nehemiah. I don't know him super well, but I do know him. He knows me. I disagree with him. He believes it's Yehovah. God says when he would reveal it. And he said he has to restore a pure language for it to be said. So now let's go back and think about when God says to Moses, they will ask, or Moses says to God, they're going to ask me, Mashimo, what is your name? What do I tell them? There's not a single passage in this Torah, which is the Tanakh, all of the Bible for the Jews, where Israel ever asked Moses, what is his name? It's not there. You know why? It wasn't meant for that time. He does tell them, but they never asked. Now, some people might argue, well, they must have no doubt have asked because he said they were going to ask. We're not done yet. Wait till you hear what else he says. But today, the biggest mystery for the Jews is, what is God's name? Now here's another thing to think about. God talks about rising up to bring that judgment, to bring his fury out. Do you know that's the same thing he told Moses? He said, I have seen the affliction of my people. And he says, I have come down to deliver them. God rose up out of his throne 3,500 years ago to deliver his people. And then he said an odd thing. He says, and I'm sending you. So how's God going to deliver Israel?
Is it possible that
becomes
one of the witnesses
that he'll be asking? That's what I believe. See, but we're going to establish that. We want to prove. But that's what it is. See, because today the Jews don't know his name. In fact, I listened to Rabbi Tovia Singer, and I do know Rabbi Tovia Singer very well. And Rabbi Singer says like this. He said, you know, you Christians, he said, you try to convert the Jews, you try to win us over. He says, and you think because your miracles, you raised the dead, you did this. He says, the Torah tells us, if you come and have all these miracles and try to bring us another God, then we know that you are a liar. You don't take Jews another God. We've got the commandment. Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu. Actually, it's God's divine name where we put Adonai. Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one God. And then the Christian, I'll never forget this. There was a guy, I met him in a Walmart years ago, and he just kept bugging me. He was a Bible Baptist. I didn't know that at the time, but that's what he was. He was a Bible Baptist. Real nice guy, though, you know. And he struck up a conversation. And Bible Baptists are good about that. If you want to get people to witness, Bible Baptists will witness better than anybody I know. They will go talk to anybody. And if you don't believe it, they will work you over with that. If you don't believe it from listening, he'll beat you with that Bible. though. I got some good friends that are Bible Baptists. But anyway, he tells me, it's the guy that he studied under, I guess, knew some Hebrew and everything. And so he starts up this conversation about Elohim. He said, "Do you know what Elohim means?" I said, "Yes, sir." And we're here in Walmart, and he's returning a TV. It's Christmas time, and so all the Christmas people are packed into Walmart. And I didn't want to talk to the guy, so I just kept trying to ignore him, you know. And I didn't want to be rude, but I didn't want to get into that conversation with him. And he says, "Well, I'll tell you what Elohim means." I said, "Oh boy, here we go." He said, "It means there's three gods." He said, "Because it's a plural." And I said, "Sir," I said, "I think you just misunderstand the Bible." And I said, "I'm Jewish, but I do believe that Jesus is Messiah." And he says, "Well, if you're Jewish, speak me some Hebrew then." And so I quoted him, "Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad." And so that kind of, he said, "Whoa, you do know Hebrew then." I said, "Elohim means the self-existing one." And see, Julie's Jewish, and she just said, "Mm-hmm." But then he said, "But he told me it was plural. He said that Yod Mem on there was plural." I said, "Yes. Why is it plural?" Because God can be whatever He wants to be. Even the rabbis could figure that one out. You know how we figured it out? Because Moses said the guy that was there at the burning bush, it was a pillar of fire called the angel of the Lord. Moses said it was Yod Heh Vav Heh. It was God. The man that comes up in a human body with two other angels beside him and talks to Moses, he said it was God. And the Bible says that God is a spirit and cannot be seen. It's just God all along. All it is God is just doing different things. When you say Yeshua, you're saying God is salvation. Yeshua. That's when you should look into redemption. See, the thing is, this is what makes sense for Jewish people. If I can get a Jewish person to sit down long enough with me and we go into this, I'm going to ask them, why did he smite the rock? Why did God command Moses? And I know the first thing I get, especially with people that know their Bible somewhat, they'll say, "God never said to Moses, smite the rock. He said, speak to that rock." I said, that was 38 years into the journey, not the first 2 weeks of the journey. 2 weeks after Moses comes out and they're on the journey, they're thirsting to death. Now, this is how you know they don't have any Holy Spirit, because they just come through the sea, 240-foot walls of water on both sides, walking on dry ground, and they're sitting there looking at that, getting through that Red Sea in a total amazement. And in 2 weeks after that kind of miracle, they say, "I wonder, you're just dried up, Moses. God ain't with you. We're out here thirsting to death." You know, there's a reason why they were thirsting, though. God had to make them thirsty so they would desire to want to drink. That's what happens to you as a Gentile believer. Before you became a believer, something had to make you thirsty. Something began to work on your inside of you, and you begin to desire something that you didn't have. Israel was playing out parts only so that we could put the pieces together later. Do you know they went through that so that the Jews today would be able to go back and figure it out? So when he told Moses, "Take the elders of Israel with you and go out there and smite the rock," the whole argument was whether or not God was among them or not. That was the argument. That's what the argument was 2,000 years ago with the rabbis. They said, "He makes himself God because he says he's the Son of God." They had more understanding of who Jesus was than most scholars of today. They knew who he was. They could, but the thing was they were blinded to a degree. And why? Because if he didn't blind them, you wouldn't be here. That's what Israel was chosen for, was to offer up the greatest sacrifice. Because why? In him was the tree of life. In him was the Eitz Chaim. In Hebrew, the word Chaim literally means Hashem, God himself. It means his life. And that's another plural. Because he can impart his life for you so that you could live eternally. That's what Adam and Eve had. When God formed that man out of the dust there, he gets his name Adam from the word ground, Adama. And he says, Ipach Beipav. And he breathes in his nostrils, Nishmar Chaim, the very breath of God's life. But he breathed it in him in a plural form. Why? Because Eve is already in there. She's not a second-class citizen. Nowhere in the Bible will you ever find where he had to breathe in her nostrils after he brought her out. Because she already had the Holy Ghost. You say, how do you know she had the Holy Ghost? Well, she had God's life in her. Hello. And God called her what? Isha. Not Chava, not Eve. What is Isha? That's why I wish I had the marker. Honey, do you know where those dry erase markers are?
You know, they better have one on the front desk.
Okay. Isha is spelled Aleph Shin He. Adam was not called Adam in the beginning. He was called Ish. Aleph Yod Shin. It's made up, both of their names are the exact same with the exception of two letters. Those two letters are Yod He, which I can tell you what that is. It's God. Yah. If you take the Yod He out of their names, you have Esh, fire. The fire of God. You call it the Holy Ghost. You remember on the day of Pentecost when the Bible says there was a rushing mighty wind came down, filled all the house. And the Bible says there were cloven tongues parted over them. I saw a picture, an ancient picture that was drawn of this. And the artist had painted like, looked like a little lick of tongue over every one of the people in there. Like a little flame, I guess. Not a tongue, but like a flame. And so when the writer was describing what happened when Paul was writing this, he called it licks of tongue or something. I forget exactly. But anyway, he's describing because it was like a flame. You're filled with the Spirit of God, and He is the Shekinah glory, which is a burning fire, not like a fire that consumes the forest. That's why when there was the, when we had the fire in the wilderness at the burning bush, Moses said that this was not consumed. Ein ochel, which means it wasn't eaten, literally. And the Bible says in Hebrew that it was the Esh. It was Esh. It was fire. It was the fire of God. So when God made Adam, he called his name Ish. Aleph Yod Shin. That's God's first letter of his divine name. He took, as we call her, Eve. She wasn't called Eve. She had no need to be called Eve until she started bringing forth children. Then she's called Chava. Chava also is life, but it's not the same kind of life as Chaim. Chaim is God's life. Chava is, she's a mother of life, which is natural life. Okay? She is called Isha. This here is the word fire. This here together, that makes the word fire. The Yod and the He, put them together, you have God's name. They had the Spirit of Almighty God living in them. God had to guard the way of the what? The tree of life. The tree of life is called Eitz Chaim. Chaim is spelled simply like this. It's a Chet Yod Yod Mim. Chaim. He breathes in this guy Eitz Chaim. And then he says he became a living soul, which is really interesting because then he singularizes that he becomes a living soul. Why? Because now he's referring to Adam as one particular life. But when he actually takes Eve out of there, what's interesting, Adam talks about her being bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. That's a huge argument among scholars. Some say that she come from a rib. Others say the Chabad organization, which I'm a member of, which is Hasidic Jews, say that it was actually half of the side of Adam. But what's interesting, though, when you read about it in Genesis, I'm just doing this to save time. When we read about this in Genesis, Adam talks about her coming from him, from Adam, from his flesh part. But then he makes an interesting statement. Then he says that she was taken from min ish, from this part right here, which is the very fire of God inside of him. So it's the scripture in Hebrew. You have to understand, when we read it as Jews, it makes more sense to us. We can see what it was that they had. We understand it. That's why when Jesus was on the earth and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he claimed to be the tree of life. He claimed to be the way, because they were trying to figure out how to get back to the tree of life. We knew we needed to live eternally, but we didn't know how to live eternally. So we didn't know the way back. And here comes this man Yeshua, and he says, I am that way. I am the truth. The truth is in me, and I am that life. Now, if God took Eve from with inside of Adam, and she comes from that fire of God that was in him, and God makes another being that's a fire of God, or another person that's filled with the Holy Ghost, then we must have a type of that 2,000 years ago. We call Jesus, we call him the second Adam. Is that right? He comes to fix the problem that happened that Adam messed up. I know a lot of the guys want to blame Eve. But God said by one man, sin came into the world. Okay? But he wanted to fix that. God wanted to fix that problem, so he sends Yeshua. But where is the type of the bride? You ever think about that? Where is she at? If Christ is a type of Adam, then there must be a type of Eve, and it must be that she is filled with the Holy Ghost when she comes out of the womb. And John the Baptist is a type of the bride of Yeshua. He came from his mother's womb filled with the Holy Ghost. Now I'll give you something to think about. We'll go on to that in a minute. So, God is going to give a divine language, he's going to restore a pure language to be able to say his name. And he says he's going to do it when Israel is about to be wiped out. He's drawing the nations down. And as I said to you, what was interesting, though, is the only other time God ever rose up out of his holy habitation is when he comes to Moses. He says, I have come down to deliver my people. I have heard their cries. And he did come down because he came down to Abraham. So it's not the only time God's come down. So he comes down to Abraham, now he comes down to Moses. But he says, and I'm sending you. But Moses, he's just a man. You know, even though he's a prophet of God, God says, I'll make you God to Pharaoh and Aaron will be your prophet. That's just names. God's doing all the plagues and kicking behind over there. Moses is just obeying what he says. He says, hit the water with the stick, it'll turn to blood. And I'm not talking about the guy. I know a guy that he hits the water with his stick or stomps the ground. He says, all the waters turn to blood on the earth. I don't believe that nonsense. So, but anyway, let's go back to Exodus chapter 3. There's a couple other things I want to show you here that are very interesting in this story here. All right, so God has already established with him, Ihayeh Ashayayeh, which you have I am that I am, or I will be that which I am. And then he says, we're in verse 14. And he said, thus shalt thou say to the children of Israel, Ihayeh, I am, has sent me to you. And God said, and by the way, when he says, that's still a future tense because he's got the aleph in there, has sent me unto you. God so ever moreover to Moses, thus shall you say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever. This is my memorial to all generations. You may have it a little bit worded a little different, but that's okay. Go gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, has appeared to me, saying, I have surely visited you and have seen that which is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Amorite, the Perizzite, and the Hivite, and the Jebusite, and the land flowing with milk and honey. And they shall hearken to thy voice. Now that's the children of Israel. They're going to listen to them. Listen to him. As you move on down, though, I'm trying to find the actual place where he says this. Okay, yes, let's go into the next chapter, chapter 4. God is still carrying on this conversation with Moses. So he had a quite lengthy conversation with him. And let's start with verse 7. He said, put thy hand into thy bosom. Actually, back up. This is where he tells him to throw a staff down on the ground. It turns to a serpent. He takes it up by the tail. And goes back into a staff again, and now he's telling him to put his hand to his bosom, and behold, it was turned again as the other flesh. This is in chapter or verse 7. This is where it gets interesting. Verse 8, and it shall come to pass, if they will not believe thee, or if they will not believe you, nor hearken to the voice of the first sign, that they will believe the voice of the latter sign. Now, that may not sound strange to you, but to me it does. He says to him, it shall come to pass, if they will not believe you, nor hear your voice, or hearken to the voice, or listen to the voice of the first sign, they will believe the voice of the latter sign. I remember when the Lord really began to deal with me, and I'm thinking to myself, wow, that would have been confusing for me. If they don't hear you, if you break it down in layman's terms, if they don't believe you now, they're going to believe you later. If they don't believe me now, they'll believe me later. When's it going to be the later? Well, the thing is we know clearly from the reading of the Word, the children of Israel did not believe Moses. They come out of the wilderness journey, or excuse me, they started on their way to the wilderness journey. God commanded them. God commanded Moses to have them all circumcised, and this is what's really funny too. He has his son Gershom, and he's not circumcised his son. He's on his way back to Egypt, and God has to use his wife to circumcise the child. He says, "You're a bloody husband to me." There's a lot of significance to that right there. He's all excited about his calling that he overlooks the most important thing. The circumcision represents the Holy Spirit, because Paul says, circumcise not your flesh, but your heart. That's how we know that it's a type of the receiving of the Holy Ghost. That's what the covenant that God gave Abraham was, a circumcision of the flesh as a sign that he had believed God. And when you believe God, God fills you with the Holy Spirit. And it's the circumcision, it is the covenant between you and God that y'all are become one. And believe me, it's not nowhere near as hard to get as what most people make it out to be. And I don't know about you guys, but I don't think that you just got to go out, you got to speak in tongues to get the Spirit of God. He told us to Israel, you know what he said to us? Jesus stands himself on the Mount of Olives and he says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I would have hovered you as a hen with her own brood. He said, but you would not. He said, your house is left to you desolate until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Baruch haba hu b'shem Adonai. What house was he talking about? He's not talking about the temple. That's what you think he's talking about. Although the temple is a type, because like Rabbi Orly taught us as Jews, he said the temple is laid out like the human body. And the Chodesh V'Chodeshim, the Holy of Holies, sits in the same place as the human heart does. And that's where God's presence dwelt, was in the Holy of Holies in the temple. In fact, to show you how much more the temple represents the human body, when they would offer the sacrifice and they'd pour the blood and then they would wash that blood out, That blood went down a little trough through the floor and out the side of the temple, just like Yeshua was stabbed with a spear in his side to see if he was dead yet. And water and blood came out separated. When they would clean that blood from the sacrifice, the water and the blood would be separated, coming out the side of the temple. They said, the Bible says in Zechariah 12, we will look upon him whom we have pierced. In Hebrew it says, thrust through. And yes, he was pierced, his hands and his feet. That's true. But if you try that with a Jewish person that knows, you get a good rabbi, he's going to tell you, it doesn't say pierced, it says thrust through. Well, that's exactly right. He was thrust through. In fact, the thrusting through was what caused the Samaritan woman to know that he was the rock in the wilderness. He told the woman in the wilderness there, or the Samaritan woman, he said, bring me a drink. She said, sir, the well's deep. You have nothing to draw with. He said, if you knew what it was he was talking with, you'd ask me for a drink. I'll give you water. You don't come here anymore. He's talking about what? The Holy Ghost. He's talking about the Spirit of God. He's talking about restoring what Adam and Eve lost all those thousands of years ago. And he gave her a sign to look for. Water. Moses smote the rock in the wilderness 1,500 years before that particular hour. And when he smote that rock, the water came forth. And who smote it? Moses and the elders of Israel. When Yeshua came up, he was judged by the elders of Israel and the high priest. And then he was smote on Calvary. And when he was smote on Calvary, when that Roman soldier drove that spear in his side, the water came out showing that he was indeed the very rock that Moses smote in the wilderness. And by the way, that's where we know the definite article hey in Hebrew represents thee as the only one, because in Hebrew it says Hatsua, which means the rock. And that was the same rock that was there 2 weeks into the journey as it was 38 years in the journey at another place altogether. And even the rabbis know it's always the same rock. Why? Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And then that rock ended up being on Calvary. And Paul said that Yeshua was that rock. And so when his side was smote, the water came out, and she didn't. I believe the Samaritan woman was there that day. I really do. Because he gave her a sign to look for. And so when she seen that water come out of his side, she knew then the Spirit of God was for her. Then, of course, on the day of Pentecost, we see restored back. And well, you know what's funny, though? You notice when Jesus raises up? And by the way, we have to touch on this real quick before we go back to the two witnesses. Here's what's really interesting. Adam was put into a deep sleep in order to bring forth his bride. It was the first time God said something's not good. Was when he saw the man was not good to be alone. Joseph types out Yeshua, David does, Abraham does, Moses does. I mean, if we go into it, we could break it down. I could show you how every one of them display his life in some way, one way or the other. David goes across the Kidron Valley, weeps over Jerusalem just like Jesus does. He tells the two priests, I will not return to Jerusalem until you get the people in one heart, one mind, and one accord. Just like the two witnesses have to get Israel in one heart, one mind, one accord to receive Yeshua. Every single thing is a type. Well, if that's all a type, what about Adam? If Yeshua is the second Adam and he put, God sees something's not good, he no doubt was under an anguish. Because inside of him was his bride. And he longed for a fellowship with her. And the only way to get that fellowship with her was to come to nearly death. In Hebrew, the word that is used there, we use today as a coma in modern Hebrew. And so God put him in such a deep sleep. And I guarantee you, it couldn't have been a surgery that was not without pain, because he had to nearly put him into a coma to open up his flesh. Or else he would have been in major agony had he not been in that coma. But God was showing what he was going to do on Calvary. Many, many years later, 4,000 years later, what was going to happen on Calvary. Because here the second Adam comes, and inside of him, he already says, I am the life. So the tree of life that was in the Garden of Eden is standing in their midst. In other words, inside of him, the fruit that was in him was the life of Almighty God. And what happens? He, in order to bring forth his bride, has to die. You have to understand, when Yeshua was on the earth and he was walking around, as if, let's say, if you were the ones that were there, you were the brothers, were the apostles, you sisters were there, were also like Mary and Mary Magdalene and stuff. He loved you even though you were an enemy with him, because unless you're regenerated, you're still an enemy. That's why he says to Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan." He didn't have the Holy Spirit yet. That's why he also says to Peter, "When you are converted, strengthen your brethren." But he loved not only them, but he loved you so much. He knew you were going to be here tonight, all back when he was going to the cross. He knew that. Because what gives you eternal life was in him at that very moment. If you have the Holy Spirit tonight, that's part of your life, that part of his life that is in you, that is giving you eternal life, was walking around on this earth 2,000 years ago in a man called Jesus. And just like Adam, he longed to have that fellowship with you. And the only way was to die, so that that life could be released. And then when he comes to his apostles after he resurrects and he breathes on them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." They're Jews. They know what God did in the Garden of Eden. He breathed in the nostrils of Adam. And here Yeshua stands there and breathes on him again and says, "Receive you the Holy Ghost." There is the tree of life. And you know what's interesting? Doesn't the Bible say it's a free gift? It's not by works. Adam didn't have to pick that tree. God gave him, and he gave Eve that life without any, they didn't do anything to deserve it. He just gave it to them. That's what redemption is. That's the restoration. Now Israel's turn is coming up. And that's what the two witnesses are about. So he says to Moses, if they don't believe the voice of the first sign, they shall believe the voice of the latter sign. Well, clearly the scripture tells us they never believed Moses. That's why only Caleb and Joshua made it into the promised land. That's why in the 40 years of the wilderness journey, God has to supernaturally sustain Israel, because they don't believe. Do you know there was not one male child that was born that was circumcised during the wilderness journey? You know why? Because God knew that when Jesus would stand on Calvary all those years later, 1,500 years later, and he would say to Israel, "Your house is left to you desolate until you say, 'Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord.'" They were typing out what Israel was going to go through for 2,000 years after rejecting Yeshua as Messiah. They were not going to have the Spirit of God either. So therefore, they didn't circumcise any of the sons. They didn't know why, but that's why. When they came out of the wilderness journey and they're getting ready to cross the River Jordan, as soon as they crossed Jordan, they were still eating manna up until the day they crossed the River Jordan. In other words, God supernaturally kept them alive. Supernaturally with this manna. Do you know that when Elijah ate the same type of manna, he went 40 days in the strength of one cake? The Bible says, and we can tell, they didn't age during that 40 years. It's like time had ceased for them. The Bible says about Joshua, says it about Moses, and I believe there's one other that it says about, that their strength had not abated a single bit, neither had they gotten weaker or anything during that time. Not to mention, we know that their shoes didn't wear out nor their clothes during that whole 40 years. And if you've ever been out in the Middle East, them rocks will wear your shoes out in no time flat. You'll need tennis shoes on a regular basis. So something supernaturally went on. So during the last 2,000 years, while the Jews that have been blinded so you could receive that life, God has had to supernaturally keep them alive as well. When Paul says all Israel shall be saved, he's not talking about all the Jews in Israel today. Even now, we're only going to have a remnant that's going to believe. Just a little small group over there. If 20% of the population believes, that would be a remnant. When he says all Israel shall be saved, he's talking about the remnant down to the last 2,000 years and even before. That's all Israel, the remnant from every age. Now, some people say, well, the Jews that never took Christ as their Savior, they died and they went to hell. He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Paul said, they're blinded for your sake and for the gospel's sake. They said, let his blood be upon us and upon our children. They meant it for evil. God meant it for good. And if you don't believe that, then you can't believe the story of Joseph. Joseph's brothers, they meant it for evil when they did away with Joseph. They wanted to kill him. The Jews wanted to kill Jesus, but instead they handed him over to the Romans. Instead, Joseph's brothers had the Ishmaelites pull him out of the pit and do away with him. They killed a goat and poured it on the coat of their brethren. On the coat of Joseph. And said to his father, discern, is this your son's coat or not? They meant that blood for evil. But had God not accepted that lamb as a sacrifice for their sins, he would have wiped out 9 of our tribes. And God would have been duty-bound to do it. And had the Jews not done what they did, and this is why God's mercy is upon them. This is why when they cried out, let his blood be upon us, he applied it to them. That's why you have a scapegoat and a sacrificial goat on Yom Kippur. In fact, when Yom Kippur come around, even when the house of Israel was in exile, the house of Israel went in exile 700 years before the house of Judah did. But in the commandment of Moses, on Yom Kippur, the high priest was to confess the sins of not the house of Judah, all of the house of Israel. They confessed the sins. And so God was atoning even for the house of Israel even then. Even though they were in exile, God was punishing them is what he was doing. Now, the reason we know that their souls weren't lost either is because if it was, then we can't believe Ezekiel. Ezekiel says in the book of Ezekiel, he says to them there, they said, our hope is lost. They're dead. Our hope is lost. Because they never got to see the coming of the Messiah. They weren't there. That's why in Zechariah 12:7, it says he gathers the house of Judah first because he has to deal with us first for what we did to Yeshua. But then God prophesies and said he's going to put sinew back on them. He's going to raise up the house of Israel so they have a chance to believe it. No wonder why the gospel's got to be preached in the millennium. The Jews that thought they were lost. What about in the fifth seal of Revelation when it says, how long, O Lord, do you avenge our blood upon those that have killed us? It's not the Christians that are dying in tribulation or the Christians in the Dark Ages. They clearly, in the Dark Ages, the recorded history says they cried out for mercy for those that were killing them. Jesus said, Father, forgive them for what they're doing. Stephen, the first Christian martyr, cried out for mercy for those that were stoning him. The Christian is taught mercy. But the Jews, because we're not converted, talk about vengeance. So your fifth seal are Jews during that last 2,000 years. So we see with Moses that it says, it shall come to pass if they will not believe in even these two signs nor hearken to thy voice. Then he pours out water on the thing. But he says that they would believe the voice of the latter sign. So does that mean that Moses comes back? I don't know if it's going to be Moses himself or someone anointed with that spirit. Because in Elijah, we see that it's, and it's not reincarnation. It wasn't that Elijah come and got inside Elisha's body. It's the Spirit of God with the nature that Elijah had goes on Elisha. Right? Now, here's what's funny. Where does Elijah find Elisha? Because I want to wrap up the part about the two witnesses. Where does he find Elisha? He's plowing behind 12 yoke of oxen. Now, a yoke of oxen is 2 ox under 1 yoke. So that's 24. There's 24 elders of Israel in Revelation, which represents the 12 tribes originally and the 12 apostles, or in other words, before and after the coming of Christ. He takes, though, and breaks the yoke off of one of those sets and sacrifices them. The reason he breaks the yoke off is because it represents Israel under the bondage of the law, and it shows that Elijah himself will break the yoke of bondage off of Israel. And that's scriptural as well. If we had time, I'd take you to every one of these scriptures and show it to you. Now, another interesting thing is, though, still for the Jews, Sister Julie can tell you about this, every Passover that we have, every Pesach, every Seder that we have, we take and we open the door and we leave it open. We have an empty chair sitting there at the table for Elijah, saying to God that we are ready for him to come back. Because why? Malachi 4 tells us he'll return. Now some people say, no, Malachi 4 is John the Baptist. Can't be. Because Jesus only applied half the verse to John the Baptist in Malachi 4, and that was turning the hearts of the fathers to the children. The mercy to them. Not the heart of the children to their fathers. And some people say, no, it meant the whole thing and everything, because God don't do half a verse. Yes, he does too. Jesus took the scripture and he held up the scroll and he read Isaiah 61, this day the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, has anointed me to the acceptable year, reads half a verse too, closes the book, puts it down, says this day this scripture is fulfilled in your eyes or in your hearing. Half a verse. Why half a verse? Well, the other half deals with his second coming. That's why. It's the same thing with the spirit of Elijah in Malachi 4. Half of it applied for then with John, but the other half applies to our future. Now, how do we know this? John the Baptist happens to be dead, and Jesus comes along, and they ask him the question. They said, doesn't the scripture say that Elias must come first? That's all they ask. Doesn't the scripture say that Elias must come first? Jesus says, Elias truly must come first and restore all things. Or excuse me, he said truly he shall. That's the word he uses. Even in Greek, it's future tense. He shall come first and restore all things. Restore all things. And he shall. And John's dead. Can't be John. But the second part of what he says does apply to John. And then he says, but I say unto you, he's come already. See, he's breaking that Malachi 4 up again. And he said they did to him what was listed. What was listed? Half of Malachi 4, turning the hearts to the fathers. Make straight the way in the wilderness, as John said. But what about the restoration? Well, what is the restoration? The restoration is Daniel chapter 9. There has to come a day where Israel recognizes the Messiah. Because Elijah is to restore all things. Israel is part of that all things. And we're going to close here in just 1 second on this part. And if you want to stay for part two, you can stay for part two. All right. Here's where it gets interesting. Now we kind of established the part that Elijah, and everybody already believes Elijah, so that's really kind of a give me. Everybody believes it's Elijah anyway. Even if they do debate about Elijah and Elisha and all this, everybody knows it's Elijah. They still believe that. And another reason for Elijah, though, is because, why? Israel, 2,000 years ago, yes, they got it, but the house of Israel wasn't there. The promise applies to the house of Israel as well as the house of Judah. Because God said he was going, this is what Elijah was supposed to do. And the house of Israel is going to come home in this last day. That's why Elijah must return as well. Because the house of Israel has never heard. Elijah never forerun them. And so they have to have that. Now, here comes another clincher for me as far as Moses. Now, the one about John, that's the funny one to me, though. I will say that, where people say John, because they say that Jesus said, what is it to you if this man tarry until I come? Then the Bible tells us later there went out a saying that he's not going to die. So clearly he did die. Because it says they went out and made the saying, but it wasn't so. But Jesus, because Paul, or as the writer brings it out, they said, he said, what is it if he did? And the Bible clearly shows. He's just saying, in other words, what is it to you if he does tarry? But it wasn't that he did. It's just he's showing to about John, what if he does? Now, John did see, though. He got to go up to Patmos. When he went to the Isle of Patmos, he saw everything. He saw God in his glory, seeing everything come back, seeing everything happen. He even seen the return of the two witnesses. So in vision, he did see it all. So he did get to be a part of it in that respect. Here's the interesting one here. We go down to verse 10, halfway through. It says, Moses says, but I am slow of speech and a slow tongue. And the Lord said to him, who has made man's mouth, and who makes man dumb or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou shalt say. Now, Moses is complaining about being able to speak. He's got some kind of speech problem. I don't know if he stutters, if he's got a speech impediment, if he's dyslexic like me, which that would really mess you up. But he's got a problem with it. And here the God of all the earth tells him, I'm the one that makes it. I'll make you talk normal. And you would think Moses would say, like Mary, be it unto me according to your word, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for healing me. Or in this case here, thank you, God, for healing me. You know, like a Christian would say. Not Moses. He's a little hard-headed. And he says, and he said, oh, my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him whom thou wilt send. In Hebrew, I won't bother reading to you in Hebrew. Bore you with it. It's in the future. He's prophesying of his own replacement. Send him whom you will send. He's not talking about Aaron. But it angers God, and God uses Aaron as a substitute for his voice. But Moses says, send him who you will send. In other words, if you make it simple, in other words, fix the guy's voice that you're planning on sending. Fix it to where he can say this. Fix it to where he can do it. Because he feels inadequate or whatever the reason is. But it's funny, all things happen for a reason. And God put that one little snippet in there that we could see, along with all the other evidences. Moses sings the song, puts it in the future. He's going to get victory over one horse, one rider. Not the 600 that God just defeated for him, but only one. The Antichrist that will come in the last days. The Pharaoh, the sun god guy that worships the sun god. You know, it's funny. You'd think as long as we say Sunday, that would have clicked finally. You know, Sunday. So, exactly. And I'm not against people that go to church on Sunday or nothing like that, but I am Jewish, so I still keep Shabbat. And I did a message on that a little while back about keeping the Sabbath, and boy, did I get raked over the coals. Oh my gosh. All that's been nailed to the cross. And I'm like, oh my gosh, they don't even know their own Bible either. I mean, do we Jews have to learn the Christian Bible as well as the Jewish Bible?
Of course.
I guess so. You know, I'll leave you with this here, and then we'll take a little break, and those that can stay that want to go into part two here, you can. But let me just, this is really interesting. The scripture says that when the Jewish people believe, the people of the Gentiles are going to take the skirt, or some say it's the tzitzit. You're going to take the whole, ten guys are going to take a hold of the skirt of one Jew and say, tell us your ways. Now, I find this one fascinating. You guys have Yeshua, the Messiah. You've got the New Testament. And you see, we get saved and believe Jesus. And you come to us and say, show us your ways. I'm like, what is the deal?
I can tell you the deal.
What's the deal?
The deal is that in our hearts of hearts, we know we've been taught some wrong things, and because the Jewish people throughout history has always kept the heart of God, the Torah, and we know that you kept Shabbat and all that stuff, so we know that if we come to you, we get taught correctly.
That could have a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. But here's another insight with it, and it goes along with what you're saying. The reason they come to the Jewish people, it's not because the feast. I mean, there's enough Messianic people out there, and they're not Jewish people. They're just Christians that are trying to keep covenant things that we keep and everything. And God bless them for doing it. I know God appreciates that, no doubt. It's not mandatory for you to necessarily, that I'm aware of, because, you know, there was that debate with the early apostles. You do should keep Sabbath, though. That is a Ten Commandment. And it does say in Revelation, those that have the testimony, believe Jesus Christ, and keep the commandments. Most Christians say, yep, the nine. the one number four doesn't matter. It does matter. You know, in his side, it does matter. And I've heard all the different arguments for it. So I don't make it a force of thing on anybody. I just think that we should pray about it and consider how we should do with that. But the reason why they take the hold of the skirt of the Jew, though, is because we spend, as I don't consider myself a rabbi, a lot of people do, but we spend day and night studying the Torah, studying His Word. Some rabbis to every letter to what everything means, this and that and everything. Now, when you spend that much time in the Word of God, day in and day out, without the Spirit of God, what do you think happens when you receive the Holy Spirit and all of that comes to life to you? That's why we have Jewish people like Julie. There's people in Israel that are Orthodox Jews that just recently are coming to Christ that, when they find out about our channel, they say, "Steve, you're just like us, you think like us, and it makes sense to us what you're saying." It's putting it together. Because why? It all the pieces begin to fit together, and it begins to make sense, and then you begin to understand the Bible in a way you've never thought about it before. And that's what God does that for. And I trust it's been a blessing for you tonight. There's a lot more we can say. Oh, one last thing. I love saying this one here. Why does he call them two witnesses? That's an interesting thing. They're not two Baptists, they're not two Methodists, and this is nothing against the Baptists and Methodists. I had a Presbyterian minister that read both the books that I wrote, and he called me up recently, and he said, "I'd love to have lunch with you. Could I meet you? I know you live not far from me." I didn't know that at the time, but could we meet? And I said, "Sure." I go down there and I meet him, and he said, "Steve," he said, "after I read your books," he said, "I knew what I believed in my heart all along." He said, "My colleagues are against your people." He said, "But in my heart, I never felt that that was right." And he said, "A doctor friend of mine gave me one of your books." He said, "And he's a Jew and doesn't even believe Yeshua to be the Messiah. But he gave me your book and said, you should read this." And he says, "And after I read your books," he said, "then I realized God's never replaced Israel. There's a reason for your calling." Now, so the question comes in then, why does he call them two witnesses? Well, one interesting thing, when Jesus came on the earth, we had three denominations in our day. Because the Samaritans had their own denomination, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You guys have got 34,000. So I can see God has a hard time figuring out which two he could pick out of the Christian church, because everybody would be offended. But no, that's not really why he does it. He calls them two witnesses because of his law. In the law, God requires that there be at least two witnesses before he can stone a prostitute and her lover. Remember when Jesus wrote in the sand? Some people say, "Oh, he was writing out the commandments or writing out their sins and stuff like that." I'll tell you later. I think I know why he wrote, but that's just hypothetical. But anyway, the reason he sends two witnesses is because God keeps his own word. He doesn't break his own word. They come and they preach that Yeshua was indeed Mashiach. And the whole world is watching this on television, because not only are they preaching this, but they're causing the entire world a lot of problems, a lot of grief, and a lot of havoc. Because the world rejoices at their death. But then they lay in the street. They don't suffer on graves. There's a reason for that. He needs a witness. But he don't need one. He needs two. If they just got through preaching to all the atheists of the world, non-believers, the homosexual community, they want to be called something nice, so we say that for them here, and for all the different denominations that got all these different beliefs about Israel and everything else, and the ones that don't believe that he ever rose again, the ones that, all kinds of nonsense that goes on out there. So they're going to preach that Yeshua indeed came, died for the purpose for your sins. This is the way it is. And then they're killed and they lay in the street for 3.5 days. Because why? They're witnessing the death, burial, and resurrection of Yeshua. And when they rise up, all the different opinions that are out there, especially like the Vatican, that is so staunch replacement theology, and many other groups as well, the JWs as they call them, the Watchtower Society, are staunch replacement theologists. And so when they find out that that is all wrong, then God has a right to rain the fire out of heaven of the weight of a talent, 100-pound hailstones on this earth, and destroy the people on this earth. That's why in Revelation 15, it's a sea mingled with fire. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, he redeems those that are left. I don't believe it's the raptured saints. These are the Jews that have to persevere, because the fifth seal says, wait a little season to what happened to you happens to your brethren. See? But he redeems them right at the time of death. And also that foolish virgin that kind of played around games until it was too late, she goes up with her. And then, that's at the end. But when the two witnesses raise up, he's got his witnesses. And he's justified then for, as they say, the wrath of Almighty God strikes them. I think so.